I'm very excited. I invite us to gather our hearts and our spirits for our treat this morning, our prelude from our fantastic intern, Josh Long.
All right, good morning. It's going to be a little bit of a different Sunday with music. There'll be some parts inviting you to sing on. This is a song I wrote called Beloved. And it's really about this vision of the beloved community. And the chorus is going to be real easy, and I'll invite you just to sing on it and think of somebody that you love as you're singing it. You That's really easy. You can sing along. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved. Beloved. Give us this day as it is in heaven, so we can say that each is a blessing. You are love, you are love. That's it. You are loved. You are loved, beloved. See it again. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved, beloved. Help us forgive the sins of one another so we may live in peace
as friends. May we be bold in our pursuit of hope and justice, so we will be beloved community. I am love. Sing it to yourself. I am. I am love. I am love. Beloved. Sing, we are love. Say, we are love. We are love. We are love. Beloved, we are love. Say, we are love. Yes, we are. We are love. Each and one of all of us, say, we are love. Beloved, really quiet, say, you are love. You are love. You are love. You are love. Beloved.
Amen.
What a way to begin. That song was a whole sermon right there. So as you've already heard from Josh's introduction, whoever you are and wherever you are on your life's journey, you are always welcome to be a part of this community. And whether you have joined us online or whether you're here in the sanctuary, our life together is more full and complete because of you. Today, I'm absolutely thrilled to get to introduce to you our conference minister. And Freeman, why don't you just stand up? I know that they'll get to see you later, but right now as well, let's welcome Reverend Freeman L. Palmer, who is the Central Atlantic Conference Minister of the United Church of Christ. And I could tell you about his bio and say things like he had a career in radio and TV, and he did finance. He was educated at Swarthmore and University of Pennsylvania and New York Theological Seminary. But I'm also going to tell you that he loves dogs, and his Australian Silky Terrier turned 17 months yesterday. He loves jazz, and he loves books. And he and his husband, Donald, who is an ELCA minister, live in Baltimore. And Freeman is grounded by Psalm 143. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit lead me on level ground. I think we can all agree that we need to be led on level ground this day and this season. And we are so delighted to have you with us in the pulpit and sharing it with us in worship. As you already heard today, Josh is the music of the day. So, there's more where that came from. We need to learn to clap on a beat for the last song, so get ready. We have a very special worship through music as well, a Stevie Wonder piece that he will be playing. And you might be saying, wow, I really love his music. Where can I hear more of this? Well, you can hear more of it on his website, which is jlongmusic.com. Now, just a tip, if you Google Josh Long, you might get a rockabilly musician. So you'll want to look up, and he's also wonderful, but you'll want to look up Joshua with an A, or speak to Josh, and he can direct you there. Prayer requests today can certainly be offered aloud here in the sanctuary, or they can be texted in, and you will see that number on the screen now. We invite you to join us after the service today for tasty delights and coffee outside, continuing the spirit of outdoor hospitality. And I just want to give credit to all of our hospitality hosts. A lot of congregations have just gotten rid of coffee hour because people haven't been hosting. And we are so fortunate that at Rock Spring, we have really had that sustained by our fantastic coffee crew. And there's always room if you are so moved by the spirit and you too want to be part of the coffee crew. The Hopkins even did it twice in a row, a double header of weeks. So it's not that unattainable for anybody. We are collecting school supplies for refugee students. You'll see the containers. We're collecting them this week and next week. I understand the default link for the backpacks might take you to 24. You do not need to buy 24 backpacks, and we'll make sure that that gets updated, but bringing one or more would be fantastic. Okay, we have some very special flowers this morning, and I hope it's okay if I have Rick and Linda just stand up here where they are, if they feel so moved, because Rick Barry and Linda Cox have dedicated these flowers for their 67th wedding anniversary. What a love story, Rick and Linda, and we are delighted that the church gets to be part of your story too. And now let us begin our worship.
Jesus said, "I was hungry, and you gave me food.
I was thirsty, and you gave me drink.
I was a stranger, and you welcomed me.
I was naked, and you clothed me.
I was sick, and you visited me.
I was in prison, and you came to me.
When did we see you in need and minister to you? Let all you do be done in love."
I'm
am so excited because this is my first time doing Time for All Ages. So I want to invite all who are young and young at heart, can't you just come and join me at the chancel? I'm so excited to meet all of you and get a chance to know you. Why don't you come gather around? We have superheroes. Oh my goodness. In fact, actually, as superheroes, can you do me a huge favor? Can you grab that backpack right there? Awesome. Thank you. So, as you see, I have a backpack with me. And what do we usually think about when we see a backpack? What do we think about? Carrying stuff. Where would we typically carry a backpack to?
School.
We would take it to school. Let's see. Why don't you help me out and see what's going on? What's in here? Let's see. What is that? Oh yeah, that's a recorder. Whoops. If you haven't gone to recorder class yet, you parents, you will be prepared. This is what's this? iPad. Let's see. Got a coloring book in here. Circuit book. We have crayons. Let's see. I go to pastor school, so I have a Bible in here. And I think I have a pencil too. So we have all these things used to help us learn. And in our story today, Jesus is hanging out at one of his friends' house, and there's Mary and Martha. And Martha is really busy trying to make Jesus comfortable, and she's doing her chores. You know, she's setting the table. Do y'all have chores you have to do at home sometimes? Do you help out at home? Or even if you have to make your bed or something like that? Right? I see you shaking your head. Well, Mary was sitting there just listening to Jesus the whole time, and she wasn't helping out. So Martha kind of got upset about that. And the lesson for us to think about is that Jesus explains there is a time for us to learn, and there's time for us to do things. So sometimes it's a fort we have to be playing, or we should be helping out, we should be busy. But there are times like this where we can just sit down and quietly learn. Or maybe we're in school and we have an activity to learn. Do you think it's better to learn or better to do work? What do you think? You said learn?
Yeah.
Who thinks work? You think work? You think work? I would say that our lesson is that both are equal. We have to have time to do both. That there are times where we work, there are times we play, there are times that we sit and learn. And that it's all very, very important. And that each of us should have an opportunity to learn, to be helpful, and to have fun. So I want us to say a quick prayer. Why don't we stand up, raise our hands, and we're going to say a quick prayer. And just ask God to help us. So God, help me to know when I should listen and learn, when I should be helpful and do chores, and even when it's time just to have fun and play. May I do all these things with a smile and a grateful heart. Amen. Y'all were wonderful.
From the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him. She had a sister named Mary who sat at Jesus' feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, Do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things, but few things are needed, indeed only one. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Rock Spring Congregational United Church of Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It is wonderful to be here today. I was about to ask if I could be heard, but the sound is ringing in my own ears. So I know that we are good. Thank you, Eric and Ron. Is that right? Great to thank you for your good work. It's so good to be here today. I'm so glad to be part of your summer series of preachers today, and it will only go up from here. Don't you worry. I'm grateful to be in worship leadership with Laura, who I adore greatly, and also with Josh, who I'm already starting to adore just from the song and the children's message. Thank you, Steve. Thank you for your worship leadership, and thank you, Edward, for yours as well. I want to give you greetings from the Central Atlantic Conference of the United Church of Christ, where we strive to follow Jesus' inclusive journey of love, justice, and hope. So I greet you with all of my colleagues, with our associate conference ministers, and the 160 congregations from New Jersey down to Blacksburg, Virginia, who make up the Central Atlantic Conference. And so I'm glad and grateful for you all. I'm grateful for your spirit. I feel that here. I'm grateful for your energy. I feel that here. And grateful for your support of the work of the wider church. We can't do what we do without you. So thank you so very, very much. So you did not come to hear me give nothing, but you need a sermon. So I hope I have one. So without any further ado, let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your word, for it is a lamp into our feet and a light into our path. In these moments, God, I ask that you would bring your word to life so that we might live today. May the words of my mouth, may the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. We pray this through Jesus, the living word of God. Amen. I have always loved today's gospel lesson from Luke. It's an interesting story because it's such a full-bodied story in five very short verses. And I was going to speak today about what I have always thought to be the central point of the text, and Josh said it well in the message for all ages, that Jesus has this invitation for us to step away from the things that worry and distract us so that we might listen and learn from what Jesus has to say. But I was thinking about all of that before June 24th, 2022, when the U.S. Supreme Court, in the case of Dobb versus Jackson Women's Health Organization, ruled that the United States Constitution does not confer upon women the right to an abortion. And that decision, overturning the case of Roe versus Wade almost 50 years earlier, has rocked this country. It has rocked my world, even as I identify as a cisgender, African-American, same-gender-loving male, pronouns he, him, his, because both of the profound effect on a woman's right to make an essential choice with their lives and the implications of this decision about what's next and who's next. So, I reflected again on this story. And this, the three central characters, two of them women, sisters, Mary and Martha. And so I have directed and believe the Lord has directed me to share this story from a different perspective. So I have decided to call this sermon A Woman's Place. I heard long ago the saying that a woman's place is in the home. I did not know the origin of the saying, and that dates back farther than Jesus' time, to the year 467 BCE, and the Greek playwright Aeschylus, in his play, Seven Against Thebes, Aeschylus wrote, quote, "Let women stay at home and hold their peace." Peace in this context, meaning being quiet and not speaking up. Now, in the First Testament, women did speak up. They had leadership roles. People like Miriam, who led the women of Israel in worship, or the judge and prophetess Deborah, and Esther, whose courage as a queen saved her people. But by the time we get to Jesus' day, a woman's place was unequivocally in the home. Women were largely confined to their husbands, and if they had no husbands, they were confined to be in their father's house. They had little or no social, political, or economic status. In the religious life of the day, they could not participate in worship in the synagogue, or even if they touched the Torah or the Hebrew scriptures, a woman's touch of those scriptures would have them be considered defiled. Men didn't speak with women on anything of any importance, and the idea of even talking to a woman, in public or not, was considered very much nothing you did. So Jesus, entering a house owned by Martha, was probably surprising in his day. And it was undoubtedly shocking that Jesus, a man who was mostly known at the time as a rabbi and teacher, would even speak to a woman. But what might seem to us today as an innocuous visit with two sisters, Jesus was actually doing something profoundly countercultural and frankly revolutionary when one looks at the treatment of women in his day. And I'd like to lift up three things from these five verses that I think are important for us in our faithful living as women, men, all genders, who I believe are part of the Church of Christ. First, Jesus is willing to have a conversation with anybody who will listen. That was abundantly clear if anybody knew in Jesus' day this story, because talking to a woman was such a religious and social taboo. But that was Jesus' nature then, and I want to submit to you that's still Jesus' nature today. One need not be a specific gender, or for that matter, a specific gender identity or gender expression to have a conversation with Jesus. One does not have to be a certain race to have a conversation with Jesus. One does not have to have a certain level of education or be born in a particular country or speak a particular language or vote the slate of a particular political party or even be part of a particular church or denomination or even faith, I believe, to have a conversation with Jesus. By his willingness to transgress social norms and have that conversation with Mary, it is clear from today's text that Jesus is willing here and now to have a conversation with any of us at any time. Amen. The hard part is for any of us to take the time and sit down and have a conversation with Jesus. I can't speak for, that was Martha's challenge. Distracted, Jesus says, by her many, worried and distracted by her many tasks. I can't speak for you, my friends, but Rock Spring, I could only wish that getting the house clean was the only thing that worried and distracted me. Imagine if Martha had MSNBC, CNN, C-SPAN, God bless her, Fox News, Netflix, HGTV, or the History Channel. Imagine if Martha had Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, or TikTok. And God help Martha if she had an Amazon app. Today, on July 17, 2022, we are similarly distracted by worries and tasks and duties and responsibilities and all kinds of things that can distract us and divert our attention and change our focus at any given moment. And the challenge exists very much so to sit and declutter and clear the space in our souls to hear what Jesus has to say to us. But as far as I can tell, that invitation that Jesus extends has not been rescinded. It's always our choice to take the time and push away all those things that can worry and distract us so that we can listen. And secondly, when we do make that choice to take Jesus up on the invitation, the scripture says that following Mary's example, we choose the better part. As Josh wonderfully said, it hardly was because Martha was doing anything bad. It was important. We can all sympathize, I think, with Martha when she asked Jesus, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself?" But I imagine Jesus' compassionate response, as Steve read, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things, but few things are needed, indeed only one. Mary has chosen the better part." But what is the better part? Jesus doesn't say. We don't even know what Jesus said to Mary. That's not necessarily a bad thing, I think, my friends. Maybe it's even refreshing in a world where people too often want to put words in Jesus' mouth and tell everybody what they need to think and believe. But partly because we don't know what Jesus said to Mary, I want to submit to you today, my friends, that perhaps the better part is this, that Jesus has a word to say that makes life better for anybody who listens to it. For a person who is discouraged, maybe that's a word of encouragement. For a spouse or a partner mourning the loss of their beloved, maybe it's a word of comfort. For somebody who is ill, whether it's in body or mind or spirit, maybe it's a word of healing. In Mary's context, I want to think that maybe, just maybe, Jesus spoke to Mary a word of possibility beyond her confines of her status and her place as a woman. What was expected of a woman was precisely what Martha was doing, all the tasks, the cooking, the dusting, the scrubbing, the rearranging, the sweeping, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But Martha may have been doing these things not just because company was there. Martha may have been doing these things because that's what women did to stay in their place. And maybe Jesus invited Mary with a word of possibility to a place that was different than what was expected of her. Maybe that was the better part. And maybe what Jesus was saying here was that women could be what was expected of what women were and more. I grew up not far from here, as you know, in an African-American Baptist church in Washington. And during my childhood, it was unthinkable to imagine that a woman could be a pastor. A woman could do maybe the morning prayer, I guess if all the men were sick or something. A woman could be named a deaconess, as my mom was and still is, and prepare communion for service or for people who weren't able to be there. Or sometimes when a woman actually showed up in a pulpit, they were called an evangelist. But the idea of conferring the title of reverend on a woman was absolutely unthinkable. But I suspect that many women began to hear what perhaps Jesus said to Mary. Yes, you can be my disciple. Yes, you can be my witness. Yes, you can even follow me as a preacher and teacher. And my friends at Rock Spring, you ought to know that the body of Christ has been the better for it. My childhood church does now have women in pastoral leadership. But one of the things I so love about this church is your pastoral leadership is a super team of women. How wonderful is that? It's so wonderful. I just am so excited every time I think about it. How did that come to be? Somebody somewhere listened to Jesus and heard a word of place and possibility and potential beyond the confines of humanly contrived and confined roles and expectations. If that isn't the better part, Rock Spring, I don't know what is. Lastly, all redundancy intended. The best part about the better part is that it won't be taken away. This is what Jesus says to Martha in the last line of today's text. Mary has chosen the better part, and it won't be taken away from her. As Luke wrote that, Jesus was extremely final about that. The long chapter of Luke that goes with this commissioning of disciples, the story of the Good Samaritan, ends with that declaration, period. There's no question, no sermon talk back, no argument, no uncertainty. To me, that's good news. Amen, thank you. I think it is. Why is that good news? Why? It's because to me, it says to me that whatever the word is that Jesus has to speak for us in our living, that's the last word. Considering women who now feel they have no right to exercise freedom over their bodies, it's good to know that no court decision has the last word. For African Americans being threatened with the systematic dismantling of the right to vote that our ancestors marched and bled and died for, it's good to know that no political manipulation has the last word. Yeah. Amen. For members of LGBTQ plus communities who with validity are worried about their right, our rights to love and to marry and to live authentically, it is good to know that no legal action will still have the last word. We all know, all too well, how human beings use words over the centuries to hurt, demean, oppress, dehumanize, and confine women and others to stay in their place. But let me tell you today, Jesus has a word for everyone. no exception. And that word can place us on a place of equal footing, a place of equal status, and in God's reign. And no human being or collection of human beings anywhere at any time has the last word on our lives, don't have the last word of our possibility, don't have a last word on our potential. They don't have the last word on our destiny. Only Jesus does. And Rock Spring Congregational Church, it's your call. And it's nothing that's so new for you because you do so much of it well, to make that message known. I see that. I read your website. I do my research. I see how you spread the love of Christ through your work in racial justice, your work, the refugee picnic that you're going to have soon, the way you're now lifting up the stories of indigenous people, the way you pursue environmental justice, and recently a ministry that's so needed now in reproductive justice. By doing these things, you're speaking the word of Jesus's love in action. And as they say, my friends, actions do speak louder than words. This world that is so fractured and so divided and so torn needs precisely what Jesus is saying to you as Jesus' body of Christ in word and in deed. So I want to tell you, Rock Spring, you keep on. We always had a saying in my church, keep on keeping on. But I want to rephrase that and say, keep on speaking on. Amen? Keep on speaking on, because what you're doing is for the sake, for the sake of the rightful place of everyone, of women, of people of color, of indigenous people, of immigrants and political refugees, of LGBTQ plus communities, of people of different physical abilities. You're speaking on behalf of everyone, and keep on speaking on and doing the work of Jesus so that everybody everywhere will know their rightful place in God's realm of shalom. Do that with blessing for the sake of Jesus Christ. God bless you and amen. Amen.
It's probably one of my favorite songs of all time, a list of many favorite songs. It's a song by Stevie Wonder, Love's in Need of Love Today, and the song he wrote about 40 years ago still rings very true. The message that we need the love of God, love of Jesus more than ever. Good morning or evening, friends. Here's your friendly announcer. I have serious news to pass on to everybody. What I'm about to say could mean the world's disaster. Could change your joy and laughter to tears and pain. It's that love's in need of love today. Don't delay, send yours in right away. Hate's gone around, breaking many hearts. Stop it, please, before it's gone too far.
the force of evil plans to make you his possession, and it will, if you let it, destroy everybody. We all must take precautionary measures. If love and peace you treasure, then you'll hear me when I say that love that loves in need of love today. Don't delay, send yours in right away. See hate going around, breaking many hearts. Stop it, please, before it's gone too far. That love's in need of love today. Don't delay, see, send yours in right away. See hate go around, breaking many hearts. Stop it, please, before it's gone.
Knowing that music was prayer, I invite us to continue in a spirit of prayer. Holy One, sojourner with us. Today we pray that we can know our place, that we can know our place beside still waters and our place beside rooms where injustice rages, our place beside green valleys and beside people who walk with grief, our place in talking with the man from Nazareth who believed in loaves and fishes and in eating honey with John the Baptist, and in the way we can use our own hands and make a miracle. To know our place in speaking out with immigrants and refugees, with people who are afraid, with 10-year-olds who need abortions. Our place in choosing the better part and making the better part real between us and among us, in choosing the better part of learning so that we can act, in learning so that we can be part of your creation, in learning so that the better part can be something that has never come yet on earth, but that we believe could someday be real. Oh God, we pray that today we can sit and declutter all that is getting in the way of the deepest conversation inside of us. For those of us who have only worked, may we have some places for play. For those of us who have learned so much, may we have space to act and make what we've learned real. And may all of us have resting places, places where we can come and hear the sacred yes that you say to us each day, the yes written through creation. When we don't know what to do next, oh God, may we turn toward what grows green. May we believe everything the stems and branches say, and look for the blossom that was not there yesterday. May we know that the only investment we need to make today is in light that cannot remain, and what will feed us, then disappear. May we risk being lost because we are never truly lost from you. And may we trust that on a trail back, a stranger will raise a hand in silent greeting, and we will know we are in the right place. And oh God, when we feel that ache for creation and for your people, may we welcome it when it comes, because it means that we find all of this is worth saving. Hear now our prayers this morning, spoken out loud to you in the sanctuary, or given to you in silence inside of us.
We ask for prayers of healing for Peter Geiger, having outpatient knee surgery this week. There's gratitude for the music ministry of Josh this morning. from Kathleen Kleinbohr, prayers for the family of Priscilla Holbert, who died on Friday. Prayers for Susan and Jenya. And finally, a prayer request for women's reproductive rights in this country and justice for all, God's justice for all people.
Oh God, what is the best part? May we ask that question and may we listen for your reply in all the better parts. May our eyes and our spirits, our hands and our hearts and our feet be open to the better parts written across creation. May we glory in summer sun and fruit that changes on vines and feeds. May we listen for your words spoken through those who encourage us, who help us see our place where we had never imagined it before. May we tell others too who have been written out of rooms or spaces that the better part is theirs also. Oh, still speaking God, one who invites us all into the best part, lets us participate with our lives. We pray all of this with the words that Jesus gave us, saying together, Holy One, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
My friends, receive this benediction. Run in the name of Christ. You make God's will happen. Look, the light is dawning, even in this difficult time. So, my friends at Rock Spring, sit, listen, then move forward. Love one another. Enliven one another and raise one another up. And as you sit and as you go, may God's peace sit and go with you. Amen.
All right, for this last song, the postlude, it's going to be a little bit of participation from all y'all. And it's going to be, this is a treat actually, because I originally picked a different song, but then when I saw what Reverend Freeman was going to be talking about, I decided to switch gears. And this is a special treat because this is a new song that I actually wrote this week. And I'm really excited about it. So it's called Liberation. And I've been trying to write a song like this for a while. And sometimes they say with song in songwriting, songs kind of just come out of the air and you got to pull them out. And then like kind of chase them down. That's kind of the idea. And this is one of the songs that truly that felt like. So here we go. So I'm gonna need a little bit of a clap from you also. There we go. What does it look like if we all can breathe? What does it look like if we all can succeed? What does it look like when all mountains are fed? What does it look like when we're all safe in bed? Liberation. True salvation. How does it feel when we all have home? How does it feel when we all can say so? How does it feel to know that we are free? How does it feel to let the earth live and be? Liberation. True salvation. Liberation. True salvation. When will we stand up for each other's rights? When will we brother, we can put up a fight? When will our worship be for love and justice? When we can celebrate all God's children, liberation. You can sing it too. True salvation. It's three words. Liberation. True salvation. Liberation. True salvation. Liberation. True salvation.
Go in peace.